Hi, welcome to Yovie's Home. For the last year, I've shared my own experiences in the Netherlands on this channel. But there is so much more to life here, more than I could ever experience on my own. So let's expand our knowledge and understanding together and celebrate our differences as we discover what it's like. In this episode, we are going to discover what it's like to run a coffee shop in the Netherlands. Come on in. Today we are joined by Gerard, who is the owner of coffee shop Kramer's in The Hague, and we are going to be talking about what it's like to own a coffee shop in the Netherlands from your experience. So Gerard, thank you so much for being here today.
My pleasure.
So would you like to say something about yourself, a little bit of...
Yes, my name is obviously Gerard, so I hope you English can pronounce Gerard. Anyway, I work here already for 30 years in this bar, coffee shop. I started here behind the bar, and eventually I'm now leveled up to to boss owner. And in these 30 years, we saw the changes, everything changed. Of course, the whole world changed, but even in coffee shop world, it changed.
Well, before we start talking about the changes, can you tell for our non-Dutch viewers or people who are not familiar with it, what are we talking about when we say coffee shop in the Netherlands?
In the Netherlands, the normal coffee shop is like the coffee shop you guys know, like Starbucks and beep beep beep, other brands.
I don't know where you can drink coffee.
Yeah, where you can drink coffee. Anyway, and we used to have called tea houses, and that was the place where you bought wheat. Except the owner of the Bulldog in Amsterdam, he wanted to be different. Mm-hmm. So instead of tea houses, he invented the coffee shop word for a place where you can buy legally and smoke legally marijuana.
Okay. So when we talk about what it's like to own a coffee shop in the Netherlands, this is what we're talking about. A place where you can legally buy and smoke marijuana and hash.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
But this is it for... No other drugs, so we're just talking about marijuana.
Yeah, that's it. They make a difference. We have two lists in Holland. Mm-hmm. And one is the hard drug list, and one is the soft drugs list. And on the soft drugs list is also like alcohol, you know, and the minor things. And it's also the hashish and marijuana.
Okay, great.
Yeah.
So you just covered that you are not legally.
No.
What are you selling in the coffee shop Kramer's?
Yeah. Well, we're about the legally part. It's like we're called in Dutch, we call it gedoogd. Gedoogd. And gedoogd is, can't really translate it. It's like the government doing this. So you're not actually allowed, but they allow it in benefit of the common health. That's how it started. Mm. Here in Holland, they want to make a division, divide it. Mm-hmm. And they say, okay, we do the softer drugs on this list and the harder drugs on this list. The hard drugs is totally forbidden, everything. And for the soft drugs, we're going to make exception and make special designated places where you can buy and smoke it. And that's about as legal as they could get it at the time.
So it's not officially allowed. It's not officially fully legal.
No.
But it is tolerated. And I mean, these places do exist. We'll get to it later about running this kind of business, but you are operating on a very busy street in The Hague.
Yeah,
I mean, it's an open thing here.
Yes.
It's not.
No, exactly.
It's not a.
No, and that's what the government wanted. They want to have a small, transparent business like model where people could buy a safe place to buy and to smoke, instead of going to grungy drug houses or whatever. And you know, the difference here is. We only sell marijuana and ashes, and if you sell something else than that, you lose your license. Mm-hmm. And in that way, they prevented the mix-up between hard drugs and soft drugs. Research showed that there's a lot of violence with alcohol and soft drugs. So everybody from the soft drugs side said, okay, let's get each other out, and then you will see where the problems are. It's not on the coffee shop side, it's on the alcohol side.
Yeah.
If you come in a coffee shop and you go to the toilet and people sit on your chair, and they're stoned, and they say, you're on my chair, they will be like, oh, okay, and move on. If they're drunk, they're going to like, oh, what you think you're going to be? It's my chair, your chair. They're going to fight about the chair. Stoned people never fight about chairs. You know, they think they're too stoned for it. They're like, okay, you want to sit here, just sit here.
Can you
But can you tell us a little bit about some of the rules that govern coffee shops or coffee shop owners? Like some, some of the regulations that are in place.
There are some strange regulations. We are allowed to have 500 grams in the premises, on the premises. Mm-hmm. And that means that if you have a busy business, and like every shop here in The Hague is busy, you sell more than 500 grams. This rule, they made it up in the 70s or something, and they calculated there are so many coffee shops, they sell about this a day, divided is 500 grams, that should be enough for the whole day. Of course, in the 70s, 80s, the population was less. Probably was enough then. Now they cut down, like here in The Hague only, is from 132 to 36 coffee shops. So they eliminated 100 coffee shops.
Yeah.
So all these people who were buying, they all buy now in the 36 coffee shops. So it's, you cannot do with 500 grams. So you have to bring it constantly to your shop. And actually that is illegal. So if the police stands in front of my shop and I come here with my bag of weed for the shop, they can arrest me. But if I cross the door, then they cannot arrest me anymore. It's legal. It's like this. It's, so if the police want, they literally can stand in front of my door, see me coming like 2, 3, 4, 5 times a day, and they arrest me. If I let it do you, if I say, yeah, I have a nice job for you, you're going to deliver to the shop, then I'm a leader of a criminal organization. So and you're a part of the criminal organization. Then.
So are you telling me that if any of your employees, because you have more than, you're not the only person working here, if any of your employees actually did this errand, which would maybe be something completely normal in another kind of business
the
setting.
Beer comes in.
Exactly. So the beer is delivered by the beer guy.
Yeah.
If somebody brings it, that works for you.
Yeah, there's no weed guy, unfortunately.
Yeah.
Who can, it would be really nice for me if I can just like the beer and the cola and the sinos, just order it on the online and then bring it here. But that's not possible. I have to have stashes, hideaways, because that's also a thing. You're allowed to have 500 grams. But if people have a small garden, we call it, to grow hemp, they don't grow 500 grams, they go a kilo or two. You cannot say, just bring me every week 500 grams, because they want to sell it as well, because it's illegal, so they cannot stay in the house. So you always have to buy something more than the 500 grams. So you have to stash it somewhere. The police is not allowed to know it, because they know you have it, but they just do like this. But that's not the thing, I don't feel like a criminal because I pay my taxes. Everybody is registered here. I do all social things and all these law things. We are obliged to do it. So, I don't feel like a criminal.
What would happen if the police did wait in front of your door and arrest you? They found that they caught you when you were bringing your 500
grams. Well, a couple of years ago, they caught me with my little van and my gear. And I went to, of course, they brought me to jail.
You were taken to jail?
Yes. And then my bookkeeper had to come. And show,
not your lawyer,
not
your bookkeeper.
My lawyer, not my lawyer, because I had to justify the things I had in my car that they were on my
ledger,
my stock list.
Okay.
So the bookkeeper, and so that we could say like this, and this is from my, from the books, and I have to deliver
it. It's for my business.
Yeah. So they let me go in after a day, because they were like, can I look at your phone? I'm like, yeah, because I don't do anything else than my coffee shop. I'm not a big criminal.
Yeah.
I'm not taking kilos inside Holland or sending them outside. I just do my coffee shop. So just check me, that's it, what I do.
Yeah.
So they found out that I'm not a criminal. They thought I maybe would be, And so I was off the hook after one day, and then I had to go to the judge. And then she's gonna decide, if you have to stay longer or not, if you're for the
penalty.
And then she already said, like, listen, you get a penalty, but you don't get any sentences, So they have to say, you did a crime.
Yeah.
But they don't gonna punish me because they know it's for my business. So that's the whole thing.
It's mind blowing.
With this sentence, not the sentence, but just the punishment, then I have to go to the bebop again, the special thingy for the coffee shop owners.
Okay.
And the bebop will say, he's convicted, so he don't give him his license back. So I have to wait till the next 4 years, but they do it everywhere. So I know in 2 years I have to fight the bebop again because they convicted me for something I do for my job. It's okay, I make a lot of money, so that makes it worth it. You know, that's the only thing. It's not that, you know, if you're coffee shop owner, you grow in it. And if I tell it all to you now, even for me, it sounds like ridiculous, you know? I'm like, but this is how it is. This is where you choose from. This is also what the government said. You choose to be a coffee shop owner, so this is your problem.
Yeah. No, but I guess what blows my mind is that as a foreigner in the Netherlands, the way that I experience Netherlands is that everything is just so logical. Like, we do things this way and this way because this is how it makes sense. And it's for everyone. And that's, you know, like, it's just like a very clear system, except what you're telling me now. And so I just don't understand, how did it become so messy when everything else is so clear? So
yeah, it's the only thing the like they did it with gambling, you know, they altered the system for gambling, so now you don't have only state anymore, you get more gambling thingies, and they're all controlled, like you said, really Dutch.
Yeah.
They did it with sex, with prostitutes. Mm. All controlled, all regulated. If it works or not, that's another episode. But
yeah.
But and they didn't do it with the coffee shops. So but the purpose with the cannabis is not that you get hooked on it. There's no special thingies, no polonium inside or arsenicum or ammoniac.
Yeah.
You know, it's just pure. And that's the thing here why I think it didn't legalize. Because they stopped it. They said, just keep it like this. You can control it. Because it looked like they have everywhere sticks. So if they need it, they take a stick and they hit you with it. That's the life of a coffee shop. Nah, it's not that bad. But you learn to live with it.
Yeah. How are you paying taxes on something that you're presumably legally not allowed to?
Nah, but we're Holland, we're Holland. Everybody. I mean, really everybody. If you make money, you have to pay taxes.
Yep.
So if you're a burglar, or your prostitute, or your coffee shop owner. Not like we're the... Well, we're the same.
Yeah, well, no, burglars, I mean, that's not even a little... That's not even like this, right? But prostitution...
Prostitution is legal. Yeah. I'm in between. And the burgling is criminal.
Yeah.
And we all three have to pay taxes. We have to say where our income is coming from. So you pay income taxes.
Yep.
Then, like, if you have a business, you have omzetbelasting. It's like... I don't know the proper English word. But if you have a business and you make money, you pay taxes about the money you make.
Oh, yeah, like, yeah.
It's like, it's not a profit. That's also, we have for everything, eh? But, but we pay every taxes except for the special BTW. We don't pay BTW. That's the only thing we don't pay.
Do you charge BTW?
No, we're not allowed to, and we're not getting it back.
Okay.
So that's, and that comes because we don't have any bonnetjes. You know, if you have a business, you have to take your bonnetjes to your boss to get money.
Yeah.
And the boss takes it to the taxes and says, look, I pay taxes, I want to get it back. With the soft drugs, you can't get bonnetjes because the guys who supply you, they are illegal. I know a lot of guys who would love to be legal, you know, because all this stress is not worth it. You make a little less money, but like me, for me, it wouldn't make even that big of it doesn't even change anything for me because everybody is here already legal.
No, so in the United States, for example, with cigarettes, a pack of cigarettes is $8 or something. I don't know how much it costs. But of that $8, like $6 is taxes.
Yeah, that's the same here.
So if you were to buy, like, it would be interesting. Because those $6 that I'm talking about is then used to fund anti-smoking programs or things like that. I would be interested in seeing something like that here, where you were basically charging customers BTW, and then that money was being used for...
Yeah, we would love that too, but the thing is, then they make you legal. And if you're legal, they cannot shut you down when they want to. That's the whole thing.
How often does that happen? In your 30 years in this business?
Not often.
No.
And the people who got shut down, they f***ed up. They sell to minors and things like that.
Okay.
And other people didn't pay taxes. Yeah. You know, if it doesn't matter what kind of business you have. If you grocery or a hairdresser, if you don't pay taxes, you know, you don't pay taxes. You get problems.
Yeah.
And selling to a minor, yeah. You know, that's why we all the coffee shop, you have to check and check and check and check your ID.
Is a parent allowed to come in here with a minor child and just to buy a joint, for example?
No,
is that legal?
That's not legal. You can go in a bar with your child, but in the coffee shop, everybody has to be 18 and older.
And what I'm talking about is specifically in Kramer's, let me just paint a picture for you. You have one kind of separate entrance where you can go ahead and buy your joint. We'll show a little video of it here. And then on another side of the street with a separate entrance, you have the smoking room.
Yeah, smoking room, bar. Yeah.
So if we say, for example, that the parent goes in and buys themselves a joint that they're going to smoke later on, they're not necessarily exposing their child to smoke, to the smell. There is nothing. It's just like...
Yeah, you're not allowed to smoke in a coffee shop, so they...
Yes. Yeah,
so but they're not allowed to go in. It's even like that moms come with the...
The bakfiets?
Yeah, with the bakfiets, with the kinderwagen.
Yeah?
And they...
Oh, yeah.
And not even for themselves. You know, we had moms say like, yeah, I have to buy a joint for my husband when he comes home.
Yeah.
So I'm like, okay, what do you want to do? Because I go inside. Otherwise, they have to leave the kinderwagen outside.
Yeah.
You know? And they're not even smoking themselves.
Yeah.
And they're not even gonna smoke it where the kids sit. It's just for dad, who smokes it outside when he comes back from work in the garden. You know, even the mothers will say like, yeah, can I come in? I won't. There's no smoke here. I'm not gonna feed him drugs. I'm like, no, I know, but it's not allowed.
That's interesting because across the street is also a wine bar or like a wine
shop. It's not and you can go with your child inside.
I find this so interesting. Like these differences when actually they're so similar if you consider like a glass of wine or a glass of beer and some puffs of a joint.
Yeah,
it's the same. You're not suddenly becoming a different person if you smoke a little bit of weed.
Now I had a dad who drank 2-3.5 liters a beer when he comes from working very hard. So you know, he didn't hit us, he just fell asleep on the couch, he was a good dad, he was just drinking a lot every day, but that was the only thing. So is it bad or not? I don't know. You know, it's the people to judge, not the government.
Yeah, I agree. I think it's with how responsibly you can use it. Like there's a difference between somebody who is just like smoking weed all day and is not able to, I don't know,
function
versus somebody who does it after a long day to relax. Yeah.
Really, because it's so normal to get a glass of wine.
Yeah.
And
accepted.
Okay.
But can we talk a little bit about, because I want to remove some of the stigma that is associated with coffee shops. So without naming names, can you tell us about some of the types of people who actually are buying marijuana?
Yeah, in the morning, we have a whole group who's coming here already for 20, 30 years, old men like me. And they come here, drink a coffee, smoke a joint together, talk about the news, the newspaper, the football.
Really?
Yeah.
And like a group of, it's like their club, like a social club.
It's like a social club, and they do their shopping.
Older,
you know, and the wives know they're here. And so in the morning they come, it's about 10, 15 guys every day. And then in the afternoon the youngsters come in. And then and very, very early, it's most of the times are the nurses and the policemen and the firemen. They end the shift at 8 and we're open at 9. So they come just, you know. But we have a lot of different kind of people because it's the same with everything. With drinking, a lot of different kind of people drink and a lot of different kind of people smoke. So we get the housewife, teachers, you name it. You name it.
Doctors, maybe?
Doctors, yeah, a lot of nurses.
Yeah.
Politicians, yeah, we had some politicians coming here. But there's a lot of people coming. We have a lot of diplomats. You know, because in their country it's not allowed. Here it's allowed, so they want to or try it or like it or did it already. So we got a lot of difference.
Would you say that your clientele is more Dutch or more international or really 50-50?
Yeah, it's both. We have a lot of locals and a lot of people from abroad. Yeah.
Yeah.
And a lot of expats.
Yeah. Do you have a lot of tourists coming in to visit?
Yeah, we have a lot of tourists coming to visit, especially now Amsterdam is as full as it is.
Yeah. So is The Hague becoming more of a tourist destination?
Yeah, become more tourist. And we have a lot of tourists coming to buy, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, but a lot of shops nowadays, especially in the center, it's really busy for every shop, I guess.
Yeah.
But the nice thing is because we're all here together, we're always afraid that somebody gets closed because then the pressure on you is going to be more. It's not about the money anymore. You know, everybody is afraid because more customers, let's say this shop stops, I think you get 50, 100 customers a day. So if I get them all there as well, the pressure on the shop is going to be bigger with people honking their cars, more checkups. So it's not always in favor of other coffee shops when they close one down.
That's so unlike other businesses, right? Yeah. Like if you have a regular
business. If you have McDonald's and they shut down the Popeye there, you're like, great, man, right? I'm going to make more money. Yeah. But here it's like, oh my God.
Please, no more.
So we have this vereniging. So we try
like
to...
Like a union?
Like a union, coffee shop union. And we try always to keep in conversation with the city, and then together and warn each other about things, you know, because everybody is afraid to get closed.
Yeah.
And also, not for myself only, but what I say, if they close him, his 100 customers gonna come here, you know. He used to go on holiday. I asked him, please don't go on holiday anymore. That's awful. He has his own customers, I have my own customers, so we're not... You know, competing. Like competing. So, he wants me to go on holiday. But when he goes on holiday for 6 weeks, it was like not doable.
Wow.
Because the pressure on my staff was getting too big, and they're not used to that customers as well.
And also with your 500 grams limit.
You know, you're just, I run up and down, up and down. That's,
It really sounds like there are some challenges that could be corrected. From a legislative point of view.
We're trying already to get things corrected, because like the one strike out rule is like too harsh, you know.
What's that?
Well, it's like if you get caught, if one miner slips through your defense, and you sell him, you're closed.
Okay.
Even if in 30 years it didn't happen, you're just closed.
Okay.
You have no remorse
for
nothing.
So that's the one strike rule.
Yeah,
is that the only strike that can...
No, we have a lot of strike.
So if you're hearing this, that means you watched this video all the way to the end. Thank you for that. We're glad to hear that you're interested in this new series. Unfortunately, we have way too much information to fit in one video, so this video will continue on Thursday. So if you're still interested, then come back on Thursday for the rest of this interview.